us, and suddenly make us worthy to praise your resurrection with pure hearts and clear consciences. And all the children of your holy church, we glorify and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children.
And be glad.
Alleluia.
fight for our souls. We offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Mary has chosen the better thing, which is to hear the word of God. and that will not be taken from her. So what's reading between the lines, what's understandable to Martha is, you can be concerned about serving in the house and everything else in its place. But those dishes, those platters, that table, this house, your life, is all going to finish one day. It's going to be gone. Mary has chosen that which is eternal, and she will never lose this. But Mary gets that from listening. When St. Paul writes to the Thessalonians, and this is the first time we've seen a letter to the Thessalonians, there'll be again the readings next week. The letter to the Thessalonians, by many exegetes, is considered to be the earliest letters written of the New Testament, the earliest text that we have of St. Paul's letters, written about the year 51. So we're talking about less than 20 years of our Lord's ascension. And Thessalonica stands out because it's the city, the community, the parish that St. Paul is very attached to. They clearly love him, he clearly loves them. To the point where we know from other letters, it's the only church that he ever accepts help from. The others he doesn't accept help, he doesn't take anything from them, because he doesn't really trust that they're not going to whip around at some point in the future and smack him with that and say, yeah, you just came in for money. You just came in to look for your own well-being. But the Thessalonians, he doesn't feel that vulnerability. And so when the exchange takes place between them, this entrance, this opening, this is the second chapter of the first letter to the Thessalonians, is very beautiful. Because in the first chapter, in the second chapter, he says, you know what my entrance like was among you. That's my entrance was among you. Now I think in the translation that we have in your bulletins, it talks about the reception or the welcoming. But the term actually in the Greek is isodos. And isodos means my entrance. So when he says that when I appeared among you, you know how this went. And he says later on in this letter, he says that you know that you received it not as a word of a man teaching you, but as it truly is, the word of God. Listen. So the Thessalonians stand out. We've talked about the Corinthians quite a bit. The Corinthians, they were just a painful parish. They were always divided in all their other issues and always attacking the clergy. So there was always an issue going at Corinth that doesn't exist in Thessalonica. So it's a beautiful detail that St. Paul gives us of the grace of transformation that takes place in this community, which is primarily Jewish converts, but along with many pagan converts, of this ability to respond. It's mentioned in the first chapter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians, and it's mentioned in this chapter. This isodos, his entrance. So that it's clear that what St. Paul is portraying is that the entrance of the apostle is the entrance of the preaching of the gospel. The gospel. And the gospel is the presence of Christ. And the presence of Christ is the presence of salvation. So that when God appears, when this grace comes of entrance, of isodos, it now becomes the part of the individual who's free to respond or to reject. So that God's love, which is eternal, and God's love, which is permanent, presents salvation to each individual. It enters. Isodio. It enters into those persons' lives. And then it becomes, what do you do with it? If we listen, if we hear the word of God, then salvation enters our lives. Like Mary, she's chosen the better part, and it will not be taken away from her. It's that simple, the gospel. And our Lord says, when we mention his letter to the Corinthians, he says, my gospel is very simple. And if they do not understand it, or they don't hear it, or they don't listen, it's a sign of their perdition. And so this salvation that comes in, St. Paul uses it as the basis for the Thessalonians to to talk about the other things of the communication between them. He says, you know, he uses two images in this chapter. You know that I was like a nursing mother, over you, doting on you, running every time you squeal, every time exhausted, of course, never sleeping, but always up, and this devotion of a nursing mother over her newborn. It's a very beautiful image that he uses, a maternal image. And then slightly later, he uses a paternal image. How I have tried to guide you on your first steps along this path of the gospel. But because of this relationship between the Thessalonians and St. Paul, he talks about the fact that before he arrived in Thessalonica, he suffered a lot physically, arrest, being stripped naked in public, being beaten in Philippi. That's what he mentions at the beginning of this chapter. But he says that my exodus among you in Thessalonica was not in vain, was not empty, it bore fruit. But then he says that you have to realize that the word which is being preached is for the honor of God, not for the applause of men. And that's a hard qualification. He says, but you recognize that, and you recognize the voice of God. And so he says, I could have demanded much as bringing salvation to you, but I didn't. Then he leads them into the fact that now you also, in responding and in listening and in reacting, you too must now be witnesses. You too must also now give testimony to that word of God which you have heard. He never says that to the Corinthians. He never tells the Corinthians to be apostles because he doesn't necessarily believe that they can do this. The Thessalonians, because of their response and because of the presence of charity, he says, now you have to go the next step. For the Corinthians, he tries to raise them up above their fighting, their grudges and everything else going on. But for the Thessalonians, he says, you yourselves now must become witnesses to this gospel of God. And then he leaves them with the idea that to imitate me in both conviction, this is the word of God, and in gentleness, the maternal image and the paternal image. So we have it laid out, and I encourage you to go back and read chapter 1 and chapter 2. We'll see chapter 1 next week in any case. To have an idea not only what it is to be able to listen to the Word of God and have that Word of God, as St. Paul says in this epistle today, to be at work within us. That once we've listened and once we've responded, it begins to transform us interiorly. Remember last week, it was the principles in our mind, therefore the way we perceive, our judgment, which follows then our behavior will take place. So what St. Paul is saying, to be witnesses to this word, because this word is working within us. And we'll finish with the last line you have in the epistle today. If therefore we give thanks to God without ceasing, gratitude for this reality of the Church of Thessalonica. Because when you have received us, you have received from us the word hearing God. You received it not as the word of men, but as it truly is, the word of God, the prophetic word. And that word is that which works within you, those who have believed. It's a beautiful gift and a magnificent testimony to these people who laid the foundation of the Christian Church of Thessalonica, and an admirable one for us to emulate and follow in the same footsteps. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. 754, in Napa of 12 apostles, 754.
Glory
glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Merciful and holy Lord, and Lord and Father, through your own begotten Son, you have prepared the spiritual banquet for us. Accept the offering of this blessed sacrifice, and grant us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace, pure hearts and divine love. We may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to your holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of God. Peace to you, O servant of the Holy Spirit.
Each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
And by his divine plan, he saved and redeemed us.
May they guide your church and present to you a faithful people who honor your name.
we pray to you, Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your people here before you, especially those who have presented these offerings. Forgive them so that they may always live blameless lives in your presence, and recognize the blessings that you bestow upon them. For you are good and rich in graces, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders throughout the world, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your holy church that you established on the solid rock of true faith, and send your vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions which pull us away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those who have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have the courage to follow your will. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have pleased you from the beginning, especially Mary, the Holy Mother of God, and the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charbel, and all the saints. Assist us through their prayers, and make us worthy to rejoice with them in your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers of the true faith who have endured sufferings for the sake of your church and your people. May we truly and faithfully follow in their footsteps. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful departed who have left us and have gone to their rest, hoping in you, awaiting their life-giving voice calling them to love. Accept the offerings we present you on their behalf, and have mercy on them in your kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins.
Thank you.
Compassionate Lord, may we, your lowly servants, be made worthy to pray with purity and holiness, and to call upon you, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Yes, O Lord, lover of all people, deliver us from the evil one and from his deceitful ways. And do not forsake us, lest temptation overcome us. For yours is the kingdom, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, bless your faithful people who bow before you. Deliver us from all harm and make us worthy to share in these divine mysteries of purity and holiness, that through them we may be forgiven and made holy. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Our sins and for new life.
Thank you.
thank you, Lord God and Father, and we ask that this divine communion be for the forgiveness of sins, and the glory of your holy name, that of your only Son and of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lord Jesus, our God and Savior, you became flesh for our sake, and by sacrificing yourself, you saved us. Deliver us from damnation, and make us temples of your holy name, for we are your people and your inheritance. We glorify and honor you, your Father and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Go in peace, and beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.